Evening all on Chessbase, and I'm streaming also to Twitch TV. Okay, so we've got some more tower games to have a look at this week. This time going back to the 1962 Olympiad. Okay, it was quite hot and humid again today, actually. I'm hoping the temperature is going to come down. It's quite cool tonight, though. No, the temperature in the evening is fine. So let's go with this game, 1962, Tower of the White Pieces. So we've just had an Olympiad, but so we're going back in time to 1962. I think this is the A group. So this is against Gideon Boxer. So let's have a look at this game first. So E4 was played by Mikhail. And then we saw a French defense from Gideon. So d4, d5. And we get the Winawer. No, we don't get the Winawer variation. The Winawer variation is with bishop b4. Instead, we see the classical variation, knight f6. So black is encouraging the center to be closed with e5. But there's a very good alternative to the immediate e5, which is to pin the knight with bishop g5. It's very popular. Black now takes on e4, and after the knight takes e4, plays the very solid move knight bd7. Okay, Townhill takes on f6, and black takes with the knight. He's avoiding double pawns. He's just playing this solidly. Okay, but does white have a small edge here? He plays knight f3, and we see the contours of the opening. That later you'd expect white to be able to use the e-file, the e5 square in particular maybe. Black might be striking in the centre with c5. It's got frontal pressure on that d-pawn, so the contour of the opening already is defined a little bit. After bishop e7, bishop d3, in fact, black strikes immediately with c5. And instead of actually trying to defend this pawn with c3, Tao leaves the pawn to be taken. He plays actually queen e2. So white's still got a focal point of e5 here, but he's giving up simply that d pawn. Black took. And now. Sorry, I think I have to reload my PGN. Castling queenside. Oh dear. It should have been castling queenside here. Whoops, so it'll only take a second. I've managed to get castling queenside onto two lines. Pardon me. So move 10, castling queenside. Let me just reload this. So if we go to move 10, white in this position castles queenside. Pardon me. Now a6. And white plays rook he1, so the focal point e5, that pressure on the e-file could be very handy. Bishop d7, which allows white to get that d-pawn now, and Tao does get the d-pawn. Queen a5, hitting the bishop and a2 here. Okay. An aggressive response now from Mikhail is played. He plays knight f5, so he's blocking the queen from the bishop. He's threatening maybe to take here at some point, or to take here with check. He's letting the a pawn go in this position, but it seems far too dangerous in principle to take that a pawn here. Black actually plays in this position h6. Should we have a quick look? Or it's just evident here that queen a2. Let's have a quick look. What would be the best way of exploiting queen takes a2 in this position? So what are the ideas here? So this was the game continuation, which it wasn't. How would you punish black in this position? If I give you all 20 seconds, and that will let me think about it a lot as well, Let's come back in 20 seconds now from here. So think about how white can punish black. Maybe, okay, from now, 20 seconds from now. Okay, anyone got any ideas? I think my preference is to take on G7. Anyone else? Any other preferences if this was the continuation? Alright, you've checked with an engine. By the way, try and hide the score sheet if there's guess the move things. Queen E5 is the engine suggestion, is it, Dumajon? Queen E5. That's very interesting. Wow. Really? It does protect B2, which means the check is we got B2 protected. And we got A5 covered. Queen E5 does keep a lot of pressure on here. For some reason, I thought knight g7, but maybe this is just too risky, you know. King f8, we can imagine this is quite risky. This, if we had this continuation, then maybe, you know, check and then queen a5 check. And then it's not so clear, is it? It's not really that clear. I don't know, maybe king g8. And this queen might be able to come back. It's on here. Where's king g8? Yeah, so queen e5 might actually be a good idea here. Queen e5. Interesting. Does anyone else have any idea here? Bishop c4 hits the queen. I thought knight g7 was greedy. Oh, sorry, someone's mentioned bishop c4. Pardon me, player in the game. Let's have a look at this position. So queen takes a2, bishop c4. Now I think the knight's lost, you know. Check, check, hitting the knight. Whoops. That doesn't look too healthy. Bishop c4. Does it? Okay, so that's unexpectedly not so simple. I was a bit uneasy with the position here because of this a2 pawn and this check issue, you know. That's why I'm a bit uneasy with white's position, actually. But okay, in the game, black played h6 here. So that's something to really think about, alternate defenses. So white took on g7 now. King f8. And now forceful, bishop, well, the queen's actually threatening to take the bishop with check. He actually takes on f6. And in this position plays bishop c4. So he's unmasking an attack on d7. g7 left to be taken. Black does play check now, king b1, and he moves the bishop, which would seem good because he wants to get this like a file, maybe, you know, if takes, and he's still got this knight stranded. White took. But here black played queen takes g7, putting pressure on b2 with the battery. So another question here is, you know, on a takes, I guess there's a dangerous move here for white. It looks as though, hang on, does the knight go here, or does it do something else? It might be sufficient to play knight h5 in this position. But I wonder about knight takes e6. That looks unsound, actually. What do you guys think here if I give you 20 seconds here? This wasn't the game continuation again. But how do we extricate the knight? Or is that the wrong question? Do we all agree that knight h5 is safer than knight e6? Is knight e6 that clear? If we sack the knight here, is it that clear? There is an immediate threat of rook d7. It does seem dangerous. This looks dangerous, doesn't it? Maybe black wanted to avoid this, but knight h5 looks as though it's a possible move as well. Okay. But anyway, black, after bishop takes, black avoided this. He just played queen takes g7. So he's still attacking the bishop and also b2. We see the b2 pawn being sacrificed here now. Black doesn't take it immediately. He plays b5 first, and then he takes on b2. So we've potentially got a serious, you know, like threat on the dark squares here with the queen and bishop coordinating on b2. Okay. Now the powerful move. There's two powerful moves, and I did quickly engine check this position. The move Tao played is queen e4, hitting the rook. But there's also another move here which could be very useful, queen f3, hitting the rook, and also, you know, bishop e6 might be dangerous as well. But anyway, queen e4, and the rook moved. This does have the advantage now that white can play queen b4 check. So he stops bishop a3. Okay. And we get a very, very dangerous move now after king g7. Can you spot this very, very dangerous move now for black? If I give you 20 seconds here, white play and create very, very serious threat in this position. Anyone? Yeah. Okay. Okay. If you got this, well done. Rook e3. Just, it's got this rook left, you know, to g3, threatening to win the queen. It's pretty good. Black plays king h7, and we see rook g3. The queen comes out a bit, but remember the king. The king is attacking this bishop, so actually this next move just tries to lift the protection of that. F4. And black counterattacks now on the rook. And here is a bit of magic from Tao in this position. If rook e1, I mean that rook e1 looks dangerous as well as what was played in fact, but it might not be as strong. If we imagine rook e1, there might be bishop a3 as a resource. If we look at rook e1, possibly bishop a3 to just counterattack the queen. But in the game continuation, guess what Mikhail played here? So white to play in this position. Guess what white plays if I give you 20 seconds here. Anyone? Any thoughts? Any moves? Okay, I'm going to have to show you then. White sacrifices the exchange. He plays king takes b2. So he distracts the queen away from if the queen takes here, the weakness of the last move, the queen would not no longer be protecting e4 in particular. So say queen takes d1 was played immediately, then queen e4 is very dangerous. There's a specific reason why this is very, very dangerous. Black wants to avoid queen e4. He plays a5. If we have a quick look in this, so if queen d1, queen e4, f5, there'll be queen b7, mating. There's no defense here. Yeah? So basically a5 was a pretty desperate move to have to play. And we get now another surprising move in this position. So what does white play here? White to play and win in this position. Right, okay, I hope you spotted this. Rook d7 just leaving the queen hanging, because we've introduced another mate idea. If black resigned here, black resigned. He's a bishop down. If he takes the queen, then rook takes f7, his mate. So strange, isn't it, this game? A little bit strange. Let's have a look in overview and summary. It got very sharp very quickly. So from this French defense position, we saw white sacking that d pawn, and this double attack was kind of maybe what black was punting at. But knight f5, the first surprise. So we have this concept that maybe queen takes a2, queen e5 is very, very good, protecting two key squares in return. If that's the engine move, then that does look like a strong move here, because black cannot castle either side because of this loose bishop. So that could spell big trouble for black. So in the game h6, and then we saw knight takes g7, bishop takes f6, and our bishop c4 hitting the bishop. We saw check, and this battery being set up now. Instead of a takes, which might allow knight e6, black played queen takes g7, trying to get a counter attack. And this was really, turns out to be very risky. B5 is loosening the rook on the diagonal, actually, to queen e4, queen f3. Think about it. Bishop b3, black took on b2, and then the queen e4. Which also means, of course, the rook, well, both rooks can potentially come to g3 in these critical lines. But the idea of getting the king over here first as a prelude to the rook lift is interesting. So rook e8, queen b4 check. I mean, rook e7 is hopeless, just rook d8. So king g8. And we saw this rook e3. Okay, so this is really dangerous now. So king h7, rook g3. The queen is on that e4 square, that critical e4 square for this check here. And also protecting the bishop, so f4, trying to dislodge it. And then we see finally king takes b2, trying to get the queen away from e4 now. And now just here, rook d7. Okay, let's have a look at another game. I hope there was something interesting in that to think about from the attacking point of view. So, the next game, let's have a look. Pardon me, just one moment. I think it's black name has been split quite a bit. It's quite a long one. try and get the PGN in correctly. Okay, so here, the opponent with black now against Tao is Alexander Gunzberger, and we see another French defense. So French defense is being played against Tao in this tournament, and we see in this game the winner, mainline winner, bishop b4. Okay. E5, c5. White kicks the bishop, it's all mainline winner. Knight e7. White goes for that g pawn, so very direct approach. And now, not the gambit line, just king f8, more positional, just king f8, the king's guarding g7. Black can play more aggressively, gambiting this pawn, but let's not go into that. So knight f3, knight bc6, a4. This diagonal is often very useful, that dark square bishop, to try and make use of it on this sensitive diagonal. So queen c7, bishop d2, okay, b6, bishop d3, and black decides to close the position up here, trying to be cautious with c4, but of course c4 does potentially make this more vulnerable if the bishop's rerouting later. Bishop e2, knight g6. Now queen h5 is played here, which might imply that knight g5 is a potentially serious threat, or something is brewing with queen h5. Let's see, knight c e7, white castles. Off to bishop d7, rook fe1, okay. King e8, and now g3. What's the idea of d3? h6, it's revealed here, knight h4, just to challenge that knight. The king is running around d8. Now this bishop rerouting on the dark squares is interesting. King c8, the king's making a real run for it here. Is it going to be safe over there? Bishop a3. The knight took on h4 here. Tao takes on e7. The knight goes back, and now bishop d6. So white does seem to have something, but the position's closed. How can white get something from this position? Now this next move is getting white a big advantage, believe it or not. I wonder if you can spot the move and why it would guarantee white an advantage here. If I give you 20 seconds, it looks initially as though the position's closed and there's not too much to worry about. So 20 seconds starting from now, what does white play here? It looks like a fairly innocuous move, actually. Yeah, okay. Just queen f3. It's queen f3. It's hitting f7. Unfortunately, this loose rook as well. So, in fact, bishop c4 is threatened. So, black's losing a pawn here. He goes actually king b7. And you might think in this position, hold on a sec, okay, this one or this one. Okay, for some reason, well, Tao decides to take on f7, so why wouldn't he take on c4 here? Is that really inferior? It's interesting anyway, by taking on f7, he is hitting the knight on g6, okay. So queen e8, and he wins another pawn, two pawns, so that must be the idea, just to win both of them. He's got the pin, knight h4, and it's a bit desperate for black. Of course, if white takes, then there's rook g8, and that's a bit embarrassing. So knight h4, he just plays queen f6 now. He's done a lot of damage here. Now the knight is attacked. Knight goes back. And now we see pressure being put onto e6. If he can open up this file. So knight takes, e takes, a lot of pressure on e6 now. Okay, rook f8. Queen e5, so e6 is difficult to defend. The position's really transformed. Black tries to hit f2, that's just suppressed now with f4, renewing the threat on e6. Black plays king c6. So why couldn't black, say, play rook a8, ae8? That's a question. Very good. Someone's answered that quite quickly. Very nice. Thanks. I didn't spot that myself. Bishop h5, drunken on the moon on string. Well done. Bishop h5 skewers the queen and rook. That's not available defense. If that's not an available defense, that helps explain black's next move, king c6. It's a desperate position to have to play king c6. So white takes on e6 here. Another pawn bites the dust. So we're in a rook and pawn ending now. Several pawns up for white. He's got 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. He's got all his pawns. Black's got 5 of them. 3 pawns up. So rook h8. Now just doubling rooks. Rook ad8. And after d7, actually, black resigns here. It looks fairly hopeless, actually. Black is a lot of material down. It just looks absolutely hopeless. If takes, well, we can play all sorts of things. We can play check and just win a7. It's a desperate situation. Okay, so that seemed like there was nothing going on, as though black made a run for safety, but was just smashed. The king had kind of escaped like this, but leaving these pawns behind. if you look at this game, it looks nice for black, as though it was safe. There's a slight tactical vulnerability here, this loose rook. But what happened, okay, is, okay, the king's making a run for it, but knight h4 also frees up f3, and look at that loose rook and f7 here. So we see this imminent disaster. The rook is still loose. F7 is loose. And now we see it highlighted. You see F7 and A8 still. Bang. So on F7 and on Bishop C4 to expose A8. So he's, by winning these two pawns, well, that's pretty horrible. Winning both of them, it forces black into, black's got a desperate position. And now this bishop g4, you know, black can't do anything really, because, you know, this bishop's on f8. So e6 is now targeted. It's just collapsed for black. He's just losing another pawn. So there's no rook e8 because of bishop h5, whoops, as well. Yeah, if rook e8, there's bishop h5. So we saw just so many pawns up, black resigned here. Let's have a look at another game. So these are interesting games because it shows against the French defence. People had tried the French defence against Tower. It looks as though, I think last week we were looking at loads of Sicilian games. So maybe this is why the French defence wasn't too popular either against Michel Tell. But let's have a look at this other game. Now I think this is quite a spectacular game, which we're about to see. If I can get the PGN correct, I'll just try again. It was nearly there. Okay. So against this isn't quite the one yet. Sorry, it's coming later. Okay, in this game against Morlock. Morlock? Does that sound something like out of Dungeons and Dragons or something like that? One of those fantasy films, Morlock. Dieter Morlock from Germany. This is the qualifying group one game. 21st of September 1962. So E4 from Mikhail. And we saw the Sicilian in this game. After knight f3, knight c6. Open Sicilian. Okay, and white playing bishop g5, which is very popular at the time, and queen d2. And then castling queenside. So this offers white, you know, good pressure on d6, if nothing else, after knight b3. This annoying threat of bishop f6 and queen d6 is fundamental, I think. But here black doesn't mind, you know, he plays queen b6. He's on f2 here for the moment. You know, after this there's queen f2 potentially, among other things. So white plays f3, and now we see a6. And actually g4, forget taking on f6, g4. And then kicking the queen, and now g5. And this looks like fun. It really looks like white's having a great time here. He's avoided trying to be materialistic on d6. Instead, he's just going to rip apart black's king position with h5 and g6. Or maybe g6 first, then h5. So basically opening up these lines. These lines are going to be opened up. So b5, and then we see the first line opening move, pawn sacrifice. I've given a few clues there, so I hope you can guess it. g6 first. After fg, h5. So just ripping open these lines. Okay. Black plays g takes, and we have rook takes. So after knight f6, now rook g5. So immediate frontal pressure, crude, effective on g7. But black has got the e5 square positioning. Does it matter that black's got a nice knight on e5? It might also be threatening knight c4. It's threatening knight f3, winning the exchange, potentially. So white protects f3 and counterattacks on g7. So it's protecting, attacking g7. And black protects g7. And now this move, bishop e2, which looks as though the main idea is potentially f4, to kick the knight, or trebling is an option, again on g7. Black plays knight c4, and white takes that off here. Black takes for the b pawn, as though there might be some sort of attack going on here. Knight d4, rook b8. Okay. Interesting move here. Actually, I don't know if it's that easy to spot, or why you'd want to play it at all. Can you guess? And as this isn't, this isn't a wham bang move immediately. What does white play here if I give you 20 seconds starting from now? What would you play here with white? Okay, any suggestions? It wasn't knight a4. That does seem to have some sort of logic basis to it, to stop queen b6. No, it's not rook g1 either, because, well, maybe, you know, black's already protecting g7 adequately. You see, this is why I wanted to ask everyone, because this doesn't look like an obvious move, but it's an attacking move. It's interesting. Maybe there's this common misconception about Tal games that he plays with violent moves. This is kind of quiet almost, but attacking. E5 is a violent move. Is there a quieter attacking move here that white can play, which will be constructive in building up pressure? That's interesting. I just think it will be invisible on most people's radar, this position, this move. I'm just trying to explain why it might be dangerous for black. But let's see. Okay, let's examine it. Why would it be dangerous for black? So none of you have got it, actually. Let's see. Rook h1 does appear to do nothing, to threaten nothing. But actually, it's got a two move threat, like this. I mean, but where's the king gonna go? Is he gonna go there? It looks a bit dangerous. So let's see, rook b7, and we see rook h6. And it's undermining the soft spot, really, by attacking the knight. What does black play here? Black decides this is quite radical. You know, king f7 is played. Okay, so he is attacking this rook again. And the rook now goes to h4. It's done a bit of damage bringing the king out. And there might be an idea of rook f4, again pinning the knight. Queen b6, okay. So b2 is a problem here, and it's a big enough problem to actually take a move out to defend with knight d1, defending b2. Queen c7, okay. Actually, not forget rook f4. f4 is played now. h6. Which creates this weakness of the last move, of course, this g6. The rook installs itself there. Rook e8. Now f5. So, black... White wants maybe the d5 square, potentially. And he gets that now. He's weakened that d5 square. The knight goes... Ah, now does the knight retreat or not? Interesting. It looks in this position... Hang on a sec. In this position, doesn't it look as though... rook takes f6 is dangerous. Now you might think rook f6, but actually rook f6 wasn't played. Perhaps, you know, rook f6 isn't too dangerous there. If you imagine, well, this position, there's king e7, isn't there? So Tal's move here is very interesting. Actually, he sort of makes rook f6 look much more effective with knight c3. Okay, so now if takes now, then rook f6 looks really strong, because we get this king d5, knight d5, pardon me, forking queen and king. So he doesn't move that knight back, just knight c3 now. So it looks as though rook takes f6 is on the cards here for queen g6. Black decides to try and defend that f6 knight with queen d8. And this fails, though, to Tao's next move. So the final move of the game is, if I give you 20 seconds here, what's the final move of the game? Which is really crushing. Anyone? Yeah, just knight c6. It's crushing because if the queen's off f6, yeah, we get that continuation again. We get that continuation, you know, with just knight d. Well, here it's actually mates. Even better. Oh, it's mate. So that was it, knight c6. But let's rewind that and look at this rook h1 again to see what was really that powerful about rook h1, because that is an intriguing moment about this game. Well, there's another point about this game that black had offered literally the d6 pawn. In this position, it looks as though black's literally offering d6, and that's avoided. You know, bishop f6, materialistic. Does this backfire? Presumably, rook d8, and there's counterplay. Maybe check first, and rook d8, and there's counterplay, which is maybe sufficient, but it might even be something stronger. So instead, we saw g4 and this bishop coming back. So it transposes into a modern English attack system, which has been very popular by British grandmasters in recent years. This kind of f3 and then g4. So this transposes into a kind of English attack system here with g5. One of my claims to fame, I once beat Morugan Whiteside of Sicilian with a similar plan of g6, who was 24-20 at the time. Lloyd's Bet Masters, around about 1992, I destroyed a 24-20 with the white pieces with a similar g6 move. It was really good fun. Okay, so h4, b5, the attack can sometimes play itself from this move g6. It's a very powerful line-opening pawn sacrifice in this variation. So h5, but the intriguing thing after is white's got this frontal pressure on g7 and is content here. Okay, well, he doesn't mind giving black b2, like we saw in an earlier game. Sometimes his own king seems to be a little bit, you know, in danger, but he has to give black something sometimes to further his own attack. So black's got this b-file, but there's not enough time to kind of make use of it, is there? But the intriguing thing now, this rook h1, if we just look at it again, so why did it cause such reaction here with king f7? If let's just examine, you know, what if, for example, queen f7? How would this have been devastating? Anyone? Any ideas here? 20 seconds. Let's just review this position as a possible defense. Any ideas? There's a forcing move. We've got our forcing move at our disposal, knight c6. Does it actually do anything? If the rook moves, we've got e5, haven't we? Now, if the knight moves, I don't know if black's crumbling. Is black crumbling here? Maybe ed, and we've succeeded in getting this diagonal. We've got bishop d4 on the cards next. For g7, it could get quite nasty. Oh, sorry, yeah, 94, 94, of course. Swedish Simon, 94. Looks incredibly powerful now, the attack. Say takes. GH5. Oh, nice. Yes, so there is a real point about this. So if we go back, I don't know how many of you are amazed by this, but this idea of rook H1, doesn't that look weird? That rook H1 can be so powerful. I don't, it sort of impresses me. Does it impress anyone? Rook H1. it's a menace. It causes devastation, doesn't it? Basically, the pressure. So in the game, we saw this continuation with black cracking now, because this f5 installs the idea of rook f6. We've always got this idea of rook f6 and queen g6 now. If black hadn't played h6, so that's another question. If black hadn't, well, it just looks difficult to defend, doesn't it? After f4. This e5 is a menace, isn't it, really? And h7 is under pressure if the knight ever moves, so maybe h6 is understandable. Black just couldn't take the strain in and he's got more threats now. The knight doesn't move back, so this rook f6 idea, and then knight c6, weakness of the last move, coming off the queen, came off that critical c6 square, and the knight just pounces in. Okay, let's look at another game. Okay, so just for those that just tuned in, you know, if queen c7, you just take, you play queen g6, and it's mate here, in fact, because the knight's now covering e7. It's absolutely crushing. But okay, let's, I think more magic is on the way with this next game. This is against a Greek opponent in the Olympiad. Okay, so his opponent here, 26th of September 1962, is Lazaros Vizantiadis from Greece. So e4, and we see e5. Knight f3, knight c6. Whoa, pardon me. Let's go back. Knight f3, knight c6. And we see bishop c4. What's this? Gurko piano business? Knight f6. d4, Scotch game transposition. After e takes e5, it looks dangerous. d5, bishop b5. This looks familiar. Knight e4, knight takes d4, it looks familiar theoretically. Bishop d7, white takes on c6, castles, bishop c5. White plays bishop e3. It looks all opening theory so far. Queen e7, now rook e1, black castles. The knight is kicked with f3 here. Knight g5. Queen d2. And black took on d4 here, and then played knight e6. So it looks kind of solid for black so far. Bishop f2. f5. It looks solid. The result from the opening doesn't look too bad for black at the moment. But this f5 does mean en passant is possible with a bit of v-file pressure. Does that mean anything? Well, white does sort of give up his advanced pawn here. It's blockaded by the knight anyway. Does it offer that much, that pawn on e5? He takes on f6. Now knight c3. Okay, there's a bit of pressure on d5, but it looks as though black's solid enough for the moment. A5, and now rook ad1. Okay, queen goes to g6, and then bishop g3, targeting potentially c7 at the moment. Knight's protecting c7. Rook ae8, and white plays rook e5 here, so he's about to double, maybe. h6, and he does double the rooks. I think this might be a grind game by the look of it, actually. This might not be the most brilliant tile game we've ever seen, but let's see. After knight g5, we get one pair of rooks coming off. Now the queen exchange is offered. In the end games, we can imagine, you know, this is going to be good in the end game. So if takes, you know, this end game with pressure on c7 and c5 looks menacing, especially c7 looks vulnerable. So queen f7, and now knight a4 is played, going into that eyeing that sensitive c5 square. Bishop d7, knight comes in, bishop f5, queen e2. So white's positionally dominating the e file. C7 ties down black's queen. The knight is a menace here. Rook b8, b3. Now rook c8. Black's very passive here. So positioning, he's outplayed the opponent. C3 starting to fix down possibilities like d4. Queen f8. And now queen e7, offering the exchange of queens. Okay, rook on the 7th. C7 even more vulnerable. And it's forcibly dropping off. It looks terrible for black, this endgame. If c7 drops off, then a5 is about to drop off. This dark square bishop is a menace. Look at this bishop, by contrast, has got nothing to attack compared to this one. So king f8, it looks as though it's a hopeless ending. Rook takes. And the a5 pawn looks as though it's dropping. Knight e6, though, forking these two. So opposite colored bishops. Does that help? He's lost another pawn. It doesn't seem as though this is very easy to draw with now this menacing a pawn, which is starting to be pushed. Doesn't matter about b3. Black stops a6, and the king comes marching in now. White plays g4. He can take his time here. After king d6, h4, and after g6, he's going to create a passed pawn on the other side of the board, f4. And okay, it's a grind game we've just witnessed. This is meat and potato tile. You know, sometimes it wasn't all brilliant, but black actually resigned here. He realizes the bishop's overloaded. You know, if white plays, say, g5, and we have this situation, then h5, we've got another passed pawn over here. Or the king's also coming to d4. It's pretty hopeless here for black. So black resigned. It was a positional game. So I'm not just reeling off. These games are all from this Olympiad of 1962. If you went through a tau, you know, game collection, they'd all be, you know, wham bam brilliant games. But this was a positional game. Let's have a look at it again. So from the opening, black had some structural damage, the doubled pawns. And from the opening, we see c7 is a potential target for the dark square bishop. And the c5 square is also strategically potentially vulnerable, especially on the exchange of dark square bishops. Or if this is removed, black voluntarily gave up his dark square bishop here. So one question here, why did he do that? Why couldn't he just play, if he plays knight e6, he might have just misplayed this opening already. On knight e6, maybe has black misplayed this already? I wonder about knight f5 hitting the queen. It's interesting. Anyway, black played bishop takes d4. and is getting a strategically lost or difficult position. So this bishop versus this bishop, we've got c7, we've got c5 as issues. And these are just taking black down in the resulting endgame to win the game. So it is a grind, it's a positional game. It's just an easily won ending. So this is just showing another facet of Tao. He's just overloaded his opponent, his pawns up, and this is it. Okay. Not the most spectacular game. Let's move on swiftly. Okay. I think there's a game I've missed, actually. Knight c6. Morlock. Hecht. Did we have a look at the Hecht game? This was the brilliant game. Oh, I've saved the best till last inadvertently. Whoops. Or did we see this game? Okay, it's time to sort of perk up here. Everyone's going to have to be very, very awake for this game. It was marked out in the Olymp-based site, which is an absolutely brilliant website for Olympic games. Olympiad games. Okay. And believe it or not, it's not even from an E4 opening. It's from D4. 1962 Olympiad. Okay, so D4 against Hans-Joachim Hecht, German player. So D4. And we saw the Nimzo engine defense. After knight f6, we saw the Nimzo engine. No, we didn't. Pardon me. No, sorry. We saw knight f3 here. No, it transposes into the Nimzo engine. Pardon me again. So we get a transposition into the Nimzo engine with knight c3, bishop b4. Okay. Bishop g5. Bishop b7. So black's contesting e4 control. e3. After h6, bishop h4. Black takes on c3. And plays d6. I was just commenting on an Ivanchuk game earlier on YouTube that this is keeping the position closed. That, you know, maybe knight d7, you know, and either c5 or e5 is common. Okay, knight d2, e5. After f3, queen e7. So white has the bishop here, clearly. Black has good central control. After e4, knight d7. Can black close up the position? Bishop d3, knight f8. So black's getting that nifty knight to g6. Okay. Now, interesting. Interesting move here. c5. So white is breaking up, trying to damage black's structure here, sacking a pawn. After d takes c5, it looks as though after d takes e5, the position is much more open than before. Queen takes e5. Check. c6. And now white castles. So he's offering a c3. That looks like absolutely terrible idea to take on c3. Black plays knight g6. Let's just quickly examine queen c3 though. What is the immediate refutation if black had taken on c3 here? What would be the refutation? I think I see an idea which looks very good, actually. Probably because of hindsight of the game. Yeah, okay, some of you have one of you have spotted it. Okay, one of you have spotted it. Anyone else, if I give you another 10 seconds? Okay, I think knight c4 might be the idea. And if it takes, we can play rook d1 here. So the knight is stopping the check, and the check, the queen moves, and we've got knight d6 check, and we pick up the bishop. Okay, so I think that's the idea, knight c4. So black here played knight g6. And we see knight c4 anyway, well, hitting the queen, queen e6. And now we see e5, which is leaving the bishop hanging, but you know, the knight's attacked, and there's also knight d6 as an option. B5. Okay, does this look a bit strange to you, this position? We've got the queen attacked, the knight attacked, this knight, this bishop attacked. Looks a bit as though, hang on a sec, is this a bit of spot of trouble here for white? So tell to play here. Guess what white plays in this position if I give you 20 seconds starting from now. Now, I think, can we try and rule out knight d6 check? If knight d6 check, surely queen takes d6, because this queen's still hanging. There's no major check here, is there? Yeah? This looks harmless, I think. Just queen takes d6. Okay. So let's go with it. E takes f6 was played. So what do we observe here? Okay, the queen seems to be in pre, able to be taken with the pawn. The king's in the center. Okay, that looks dangerous. Maybe for rook e1s. Okay. Well, but what about, you know, if, let's see what happens. So black took the queen. So in this position, we've got a few attacking possibilities. Now maybe, just maybe, if we play rook AE1, which wasn't played, I guess at minimum, black could just castle here, couldn't he? What would be the material situation here? Takes. We'd have two rooks each. No, actually white's a rook down here. Rook, bishop, two bishops, knight. Black's the exchange, up here, isn't he? So actually rook a1 wasn't played in this position. Yeah, white's the exchange down, thank you. So white took on g7, so he's stopping black castling queen side, because that bishop makes that illegal, and he can't castle this side because of that pawn now. Okay, with the rook attacked, rook g8. Okay, so now we've got this some options here. Also of note now, if we take in the latest information about the position, that this pawn is actually a useful attacking resource, eyeing f8 here. It's eyeing the f8 square, isn't it? Let's just note that down. Okay, the bishop's striking across this diagonal. That's interesting as well. So anyway, what does white play here? And let's see, you know, if rook, can we just try and rule out rook ae1? If rook ae1, then there doesn't seem to be too many choices, but black, you know, say black does just play rook takes, he is actually protecting g6, isn't he? So takes, you know, g6 is not dropping off, and we get this scenario again where white is the exchange down. Knight d6 check. Well, this bishop's like loose. Bishop takes g6 first. That's a very good point, because then surely knight d6 is okay. This might be an okay continuation for white as well, actually. That looks good to get two pieces for the rook. So actually, rook ae1. Pardon me. After fg7, rook g8. Rook ae1 looks quite good in that continuation. But we can do better. We don't have to take here. What if we take here? Isn't that an improvement for black? That's a vast improvement for black, isn't it? Where's this g pawn going anyway? Rook takes, f takes. So now knight d6 doesn't matter about that, does it? Also, rook g7, we're on g2 as well. Okay. So I think we can rule out rook ae1, can we not? So in this position, if I give you 20 seconds, what did Tao play here? 20 seconds starting from now. So rook ae1 has been ruled out, I hope, just to make it easier. So 20 seconds starting from now. Anyone? This is a really crushing move, actually. It's actually quite funny. It's a punchline. It's like a very strong punchline of a joke, this move. It's not knight d6 check. Okay, yeah, okay, unbelievable. Bishop f5. I mean, aesthetically, look at these bishops, and this pawn. Look at that aesthetics. All of those squares covered around the king. So if we did take on c4, isn't this kind of mating now? Rook ae1 is just mating. All of these squares covered. Well, it's going to be winning lots of material anyway. If queen e6, if queen e6, I think white's doing okay here. I think you can play this. If knight takes h4, we can play check and get our... Hang on, white's a piece down. No, that's wrong. Hang on, forget that. All right, let's have a look. What's going on here? Sorry, what if queen e6? Bishop g6 first. Yeah, I'm looking at bishop g6 first. If we take on e1, check. This looks dangerous because we're going to play rook e7, aren't we? Maybe bishop takes f7 here. And this looks good. I think this looks good for white. Sorry, someone's saying rook takes e6. Rook takes e6 as well. It takes, check, king d7. Not sure about that one. I think what we've just seen is clear enough. This bishop takes g6 line looks clear enough. But in the game, okay, so after bishop f5, black tried. Now, if queen takes f5, we have knight. I assume we have knight d6 check. Knight takes f5. And that's good for white, isn't it? This position takes. That looks good for white. But I'm not. Yeah, this bishop looks bad. It looks pretty dismal for black initially. Sorry. Okay, so queen takes f5. Why can't black play bishop c8 instead? Sorry, on Brahim on the play chess server. Bishop c8 where? Well, in the game continuation, black played knight takes h4. Okay. And then we saw bishop takes e6, which white can continue now with knight d6 check to win this bishop. So black counterattacks with bishop a6. So two pieces are loose here. Now there's a neat little tactic here, actually, for white to avoid losing material. Otherwise he's busted. He's going to lose material if he doesn't have this important tactic now. He plays check. And guess what Mikhail plays in this position to avoid losing material? And maintain an advantage, I assume. So 20 seconds here. White to play and maintain advantage. Actually, there's two ways, isn't there, of not losing material. Knight f5 does look like viable. In fact, bishop c4 was chosen. That's a counterattacking bishop. Okay, maybe there's more than two ways. This is the game continuation, bishop c4. So the storm's cleared a bit. So pawn situation, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Actually, I didn't count that one, 6. So about equal on pawns, but black's pawns are totally, like, wrecked. On the queen side, double pawns here, double pawns. Okay, so rook takes g7. So he's hitting g2. So white takes time to play g3 before doing anything else. King takes d6, bishop takes a6. So white has emerged with. He's actually a pawn down here. But it looks good structurally. It looks as though black's got a lot of structural damage. The king's still a bit in danger after all that. So okay, knight f5, and we see rook ab1. After f6, check. Now king f2 is played, and okay, it looks as though white's got a comfortable position, but Black plays c4. The knight is kicked. And now we see this horrible pin, rook b7. Horrible pin. But the king's, you know, protecting e7 at the moment, so just that can be ignored. Rook ag8, as though maybe h5 is on the cards. Bit of counter-attack. But white takes on c4. And the knight is now free to move, of course, with the rook protecting this one. So knight d5 against that. So what have we ended up here with? Now, the rook is actually loose here. Mikhail, though, takes on d5, but he's attacking g8, isn't he? So no rook takes b7 because you can take on g8. So c takes d5, rook b4. So white's actually, out of all of that chaos from earlier, he seems to have a better rook and pawn ending here. Because if he can get, you know, these pawns are all a bit vulnerable here. Isolated, doubled, bit, you know, look at all the pawn islands. So let's see, rook c8. Starts mopping up these pawns. Check. Rook takes f6. Black plays h5. And now just h3. He's maintaining, you know, potentially two connected passed pawns on the king side. Black does play hg, so we've got the two connected passed pawns. Rook h7. g5. Rook f5, king comes to g3 now, king c4, puts more pressure on that poor d pawn, okay, d4, that also supports g6, he's protected f5 for g6 as a menace. Rook h1, check. He takes off this rook, and now king f4 means that, you know, rook g5 is on the cards against rook g1, so this pawn's a menace here. And is it slower than, like, this pawn? Well, yeah, yes, it does seem to be. It's only two steps away. This is needs three. Rook g1, rook g5, black resigned. Okay, so that was crazy in the middle game, and then we saw this, you know, end game with advantage, which he was able to win from the end game. Let's have a look at that again. So that was a bit of chaos. So black had tried, you know, Nim's Indian philosophy of giving up the bishop pair, structural damage to white, and trying to keep the position closed and make the most out of the knights. But Tao initiated line opening with c5 here. This initial pawn sacrifice breaks open some lines, so you might think maybe more cautious would have been c5 from black here, a more cautious approach. But, you know, c5 does weaken d5, you know, maybe later, you know, d5 is a problem. White can sometimes sack d4, doesn't have to play d5. Okay, but okay, so knight f8, we saw the pawn sack c5. If taking like this, that's, you know, probably risky on this file. So he took like this, and we saw check, castling, and this position where the black king was caught in the center, it seems, and this tactical vulnerability, this loose piece plays an important role in things after e5. So b5, and then we saw this queen sack, which really keeps the king in the center for a moment. So e takes f6, queen sack, keeping the king in the center. And not playing an obvious move here, though. He plays bishop f5. It's really quite amazing. Black try to keep things together with knight takes h4. So white took on e6. Bishop e6. Check. And we get this endgame, which is just seems very good for white, even though he's temporarily a pawn down. He's a pawn down, but it looks like a strong position. With king f2, by the way, this g4 is on the cards. He's just made sure g4 is on the cards, hasn't he, to kick this knight from f5. The pawn's actually very useful here to stop knight d4s. So that's a very useful pawn to keep on c3 here. White wants to play g4. The c4 move had some logic, I guess, to give c5 to the king. So g4, now rook b7. The king is stuck in the middle, can't go to c5. He's stuck protecting that knight. And, okay, black is banking on no. He's protecting that rook, which means he can play knight d5 without losing the rook. But even so, this rook and pawn ending transition, just the amount of pawn islands here. We see this is one pawn island, two pawn islands, three. But black has one, two, three, four. They're all pretty fragmented pawns here. And so it's easier, in principle, it should be easier to mop up black's pawns. So c3 for a4, okay, exchange of prisoners. Then f6 is dropping. And then h6 is behind that f6. So it's all being mopped up quite efficiently now. For this passed pawn scenario, this passed g pawn, which is emerging out of this. So rook f5. This is quite a cunning doubling of rooks on the e rank to be able to play g6, because you'd usually think of rooks behind pawns. So this idea of getting, sorry, on move 21 when white played bishop f5, why couldn't black play bishop c8? Okay, we'll go back to move 21. Just shortly, just quick. Okay, I'll make a note. Move 21. Okay, but hold on a sec. Check. Let's just review this rook and pawn ending once more. So he built that for g6. The key thing is this pawn getting there quickly. So it doesn't matter about rooks behind pawns. He's built that bridge on g5 here, which wins the game. Okay, so the question is on move 21. Why couldn't black play bishop c8? That's a good question, actually, isn't it? Actually, haven't we got a good move here on bishop c8? We've got rook d1. Aren't we threatening rook d8 now? Rook d8 is actually threatening mate. But then, let's imagine knight takes h4, though. Yeah, that can't be it. Yeah. This is a good question. Bishop c8. Has anyone got a refutation of bishop c8? Bishop takes e6. Bishop takes e6. Should we go with bishop takes e6 here? We've got two pieces hanging. This is a bit of a concern to have two pieces hanging. Knight d6 check. King d7. Oh, bishop g3. Oh, that's how you can keep the pieces. Bishop g3. This looks all right for white now, doesn't it? Because I think white's got, knight e4 to c5 and f6. So that's rook takes, or rook d1 looks quite tasty as well. I think this looks quite dangerous, doesn't it, for black, this position? So we've got a threat of knight f5 check, and it looks as though the king's in trouble, isn't it? If king e7, then I wonder about actually, it looks quite dangerous, this position. Does that answer the question? Sorry, Rohanim? Who asked that question? So I'm just trying to... Rohanim, does that answer the question? Does that look as though it's a good position? 1, 2, 5... Is everyone convinced? this is a better position. But we can continue with king e7. Okay, what happens after king e7? Maybe just knight e4. And we're on c5. We've got bishop d... This looks quite tasty, doesn't it? Although this pawn's a bit... I don't know, maybe we'll take that. Yeah, that's right. Let's play rook e1. Tie that bishop down. And that now it looks quite unpleasant, doesn't it? For black. Okay. Let's stop there. This is good. Should we stop there? So that was an interesting game. Yeah, that was one of the more interesting games, I think, from D4. I think we've overrun already. There's some magical stuff in there. Let's go back to the final position. So thanks for coming. Okay, I hope you enjoyed it. See you next week, around about the same time. Okay, thanks very much. Have a good week.